Oh, la 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 incredible story. Hi there, Marcy.
Hi there. Yes, we absolutely do. You've probably heard the expression, what's old is new again. That's definitely true when it comes to trends and fashion. The same thing when it comes to arts and music. And of course, we've got to talk about these amazing people. They came together in the 90s, came up with this fanzine called The Root of Twinkle. I told you I would tell you about that. And then they kind of fell out of touch. And guess what? They came back together again and made a special issue. Here's how it happened.
If you made it into Root of Twinkle, you were on your way. And that's not an exaggeration.
Songwriter and multi-instrumentalist Mystic Native Rich Freyas says, in the case of local talent, making it into the fanzine Root of Twinkle was a measure of success in the early 90s. Started by two best friends, Eva Peck and Vanessa Gazzari, the duo published five issues between 91 and 95. Friend of the creators, artist and photographer Michelle Gemma, remembers helping promote Root of Twinkle, especially around one of their favorite spots, Mystic Disc.
It builds excitement to the next issue, to the next show, to the next poetry reading, and all of us felt an obligation to help promote it.
Articles featured reviews of performances, poetry readings, photography shows, and more. Rich remembers being interviewed about his band and how the girls asked some tough questions.
My band, the 17 Relics, were not the most prolific songwriters, and some other bands in town could crank out like a song every week. And so they did an interview with us, and they were like, why can't you guys write more songs? You know, you're supposed to be this great band.
Michelle says as time went on, the fanzine gained a following. The group would often put on shows to keep the lights on and the publications coming.
We had to pay a heat bill one year. So we're like, let's have a dance party. We'll collect $5 and we're going to give these guys a great show.
But like in many situations, life changes. People move away and fall out of touch. That's what happened for many years until an idea came to Michelle late one summer night in 2020, in the height of the COVID-19 pandemic.
I messaged her on Instagram and I said, Eva, it's Michelle. I just had a great idea. You're in town for the summer. Let's do a Root of Twinkle. Like, we can do this. You know, we'll cover the pandemic. We'll cover the protests.
After weeks of outreach, research, and good old-fashioned reporting, Root of Twinkle released their first issue in 25 years, selling out of their 100 copies quickly.
People were like, my kids don't understand why I'm so excited about the Root of Twinkle. And so even though people are, you know, have moved on maybe in life with kids and marriage, they still felt this initial pull of nostalgia for Mystic in the 90s.
Like many of the cultural events archived at Root of Twinkle, it's important to move on, but always remember where you came from.
Future, you know, you're not stuck in the past, you know, you're in the present moment always, and you're always looking to the future, but you bring the past with you. You bring the best bits of the past.
I haven't done anything yet. So this is Portersville and Greenmanville, and my name is Dan Pearson, and I'm your host this evening. Portersville was what the Groton side of Mystic was referred to before the Bascule Bridge was built. Greenmanville was the Stonington side of town, dominated by the Greenman family, which owned the shipbuilding facilities on the grounds of the present-day Mystic Seaport Museum. And this duality fueled the artists of the time that we're talking about. And since we're taking a look back at a time and a place, I think it's here necessary to go back to another time and place. And yes, that would be 1981. So 1981 was the same year that MTV launched, and it was the same year that REM released their debut single known as The Hib Tone. And if there is a genesis to everything that occurred here, you could probably trace it back to REM's first single, In Concept and Execution. It meant an incredible amount to us that there were these people from a town that most people didn't know of making really urgent, mysterious music, and it was transformational for us. And there are three things that need to be mentioned in connection with that that help to sort of define what we're going to discuss this evening. First is the Reducers. So if you're not familiar with the Reducers, they're a band from New London, Connecticut, and they basically created a scene over the bridge with all these incredible bands. It was New Johnny Five and Paisley Jungle, And they reaffirmed what REM told us, that anybody can do this and they can do it anywhere. They toured, they put out records. I never had a fake ID. I wasn't able to go to the LNG and see them at the club, but they would play shows, and it was just an affirmation of everything that could happen on your own. The second thing that happened was WCNI, which was an incredible lifeline for us living here in this small town. Dead Air, Sheena, Rasta Tim, The Dog, Rick Wrigley, Rob Canabas. It was this reminder that it wasn't just WPLR and 103.7, that there was so much beyond Foghat and Skinner, and no offense to the Foghat fans in the house this evening. But you could hear jazz and world music and polka and new music, and you could go backwards and forwards and really feel that there was this, there was an incredible reverence for the past, but an incredible audacity to try to move forward from that. And the last thing, if we discuss this period of creation and Mystic, nothing is more crucial than Mystic Disc. So by opening the disc, Dan Curlin single-handedly opened the world to the kids here. So you could hear stuff on CNI and then actually own it. Because this is May in Shock and Surprise. The kids are here, aren't gonna know this reference, but KTEL was not gonna send you Flesh Tones records. Dan would. So you could walk into the shop at 12 or 13 years old, 14 years old, before you could drive up to Providence or Boston. There were flexies, imports, bootlegs, rarities. There would be magazines on the wall, Puncture, Option, The Bob, Melody Maker, and Bucket Full of Brains, if you're really into like Rain Parade, which I'm sure Steve is. So what was crucial about the disc was not only that you had these choices, but you had Dan and Rich and Jim and Chuck and Mike Logan and these people who would help connect you to other artists. So that, you know, you would say, okay, so you're listening to this, well, maybe you should check out Big Star. And if you're listening to this, maybe you should check out Nick Drake. And this is an unusual thing to be a middle school student in a small town and be able to have these people sending you in the direction. And what you learned very quickly was that there was this continuum, and that everything that you were listening to, the Pixies and Public Enemy, they couldn't be there without Otis Redding and Sister Rosetta Tharpe and Iroy and Uroy, Jonathan Richman and Alice Coltrane and Can and Zappa and Beefheart. And it was this just extraordinary moment that you felt like there was no end to this opportunity. And I think that's the key, is the idea of momentum. And that's what I think is important about this evening. This evening is not an evening of nostalgia. It's an evening of recognition that everything in the past was and still taking us forward and empowering us, giving the reverence for what was made, to have the devotion and audacity to make it ourselves. And to know that beneath everything we were being told and sold, there was a hidden world of art and ideas that we could forever mine, that we didn't need Rolling Stone to tell us that music ended in 1967. We didn't need MTV or the New York Times Book Review to tell us what mattered. We could independently place value and believe in our own perception. And that's what matters about this evening, that to some extent we are looking back, but really looking back to the events that informed how we would forever look forward. And I'm really excited to be part of this and grateful to be part of this. And I want to thank everybody for coming out this evening and also for your patience. The delay is not on our part. It has to do with our planet's relation to the sun. But please, there's drinks, there's food, and we have speakers, and there's a lot going on. Thank you so much for being part of this. So I'd like to introduce our first speaker this evening. Our first speaker is Matthew Tarbucks. He's one of the co-founders of Hozomeen Press, the publishing house that captured the written word of the time. Hozomeen legitimized the burgeoning musing scene by adding serious artistic heft to the cultural experience which the bands had nurtured. The Hozomeen magazine's Mason Stoop, which you can see the little poster over there, Mason Stoop created a new vibrant destination for artistic direction that many new people participated in. Not only could the music acts garner attention, but now the poems written and those who appreciated the written could coalesce around Hozomeen Press, much as the bands had coalesced around the Stonington Como All Ages shows. Matthew is an English teacher at NFA and will discuss the physical process of creating the Hozomeen publication as well as the curation of the contributors.
Wow, thank you, Dan. It's fantastic. How are we doing tonight? So I am Matthew Tarbox. I'm teaching reading up at NFA right now. And I was around in the 90s here. I was around since probably, I guess, the late 70s here. It's going to be hard to compete against this backdrop. I just feel like having a seat with you guys and watching this. So the song that I walked up to is Belt by the 17 Relics. And they were one of my favorite bands. When I was in high school, I'd go and dance to them at local parties and things like that. And they were really kind of the ignition of the late 80s, 90s, young art scene, right? There was always an older art scene. There was always the arts festival here and stuff like that, which is great. But the youth around the late 80s and early 90s started to really really blossom, and there were a bunch of reasons for that. I'm going to kind of talk about some of those. I'm going to talk about my involvement with Hozomeen Press, which was also key to a lot of this. So this is a Mason Stoop. This was our magazine that we put out. This was rubbings from graves that we got the letters from. We obviously messed around with them before computers. We didn't find a grave that actually had Mason Stoop written on it. Hold on. Uh-huh. We have a limitation here. So, this is a picture. This is a photograph of the 17 Relics. It was in the day, back in the late 80s, I believe, maybe early 90s. And they were hugely influential. They were the first band in Mystic that you really felt they were, might make it onto a major record label. They had just fantastic songs. They had several albums that they put out. I'll talk about them a little more later. Can you advance me? Oh, there it goes. It all started before them with the Reducers. As Dan was saying, the Reducers started in like 78, 77, around that time period. And they kind of let everyone know, like, you can do this. We were all latchkey kids growing up, our generation, Generation X. And a lot of us, both parents were working, so we'd come home, and there was not much supervision, and we had to figure things out ourselves. We weren't programmed. There were not, like, all kinds of programs after school for us. So we kind of had a do-it-yourself ethos of having to come up with our own sports, our own activities. There were no parents to, like, break up fights. We had to figure that out ourselves. There were other generations that had that, of course, before us and after that. But that was really a defining thing about our generation was, wow, the Reducers can do this. Maybe we can do this. Like, we don't need to have a major record label. We don't have to go to New York City. So the Reducers were hugely influential. They had a lot of flyers with this kind of style back in the early 80s, late 70s. Miracle Legion was also massive. New Johnny Five. All these bands were very influential, would kind of lead us, show us the way that they, if these guys can just do it, playing out of the parents' basements, maybe we can do this as well. So we were kind of a second generation after this. These guys were, you know, kind of like the kids, the older kids in high school, the kids that you kind of looked up to. And so we learned a lot from them. They were just doing this. They weren't making a lot of money. They were just trying really hard, scraping away. The Cartoons put out an LP from New London. New London was a huge, had the Reducers, had the Cartoons. Paisley Jungle, another fantastic band from New London. Two bassists, yeah. One played high, one played low. I guess my batteries are dying. I don't know. This was before our time. It was a Jolly Beggars in Mystic. It was right across the river here. Before these, you know, beautiful condos were built, there was a little. It was basically like a shack for fishermen, and it was turned into a little bar. There was a lot of culture going on there. So any of the older folks might remember this. This was sort of, you know, the arts going on before us. There was like band, you know, music that was played here. It was mainly the early 70s kind of thing, late 70s, before it was dismantled. And they basically expanded, you know, the water used to go almost up to the, where BB Dairy used to be. The wharf and stuff, and so they expanded out. They built these condos in the parking lot we have now. Sunrise Farms. Yes. So, Kretzers. Some of you might remember Kretzers. Sunrise Farms. This was Mystic back in the 70s and the early 80s. It was nothing like it is today, for better or worse. I suppose we can argue about that. But this is the environment that we were all raised in. Everyone up here, everyone's going to be talking here today. It was a blue-collar town still. You could live downtown. You could actually live downtown without a car. So it was a different culture in Mystic at that time. This was not here. This was just a bunch of rotting wood for cockroaches, right? This was a huge, like, just rats and things like that. You know? This was not, I mean, this is beautiful. So thank God this was done. BB Dairy, right? Yes. Right, Jeff Gordon, you're out there somewhere. This was where all the artists would eat down in Mystic, because you could get a nice cheap meal here. You get pancakes at 7 o'clock at night. This was right downtown on the main street, and it was cheap. It was like a diner. I remember telling Rich Freitas, we'd see all the old guys sitting in the U. Like, it was like a U-shaped counter. Someday we're going to be chilling out there at that counter. Unfortunately, you know, they took it away. But across the street, there's a little empty vacancy. John's was also a center, something, an institution of Mystic. Two pool tables, a couple video games. Was it one pool table? I could be wrong about that. Just fantastic. You could get a Ballantine for like 50 cents. So artists, you know, enjoyed going there. And it was right downtown. Again, everything was walkable, right? There was a triumvirate, though. There were three key Mystic locations that really had the arts going, that fed the arts and fed off of the arts. First was Green Marble. I was not a big coffee drinker, but everyone is at Green Marble. I think half the youth of Mystic worked there at some point. You could always go down there, find somebody, talk to somebody. Artists were hanging out there, having coffee, having tea. And the fantastic thing was, it was right next to, the Mystic Disc, which Dan mentioned earlier, the nexus. Okay, the focal point of Mystic was Mystic Disc. He could get you anything. This was before Amazon. This was like, I was into some bands. It was really hard to get the stuff. You'd have to drive to Providence, New York, go in some basement somewhere. you know, to find a bootleg, a live recording, Dan could get it for you. Plus, you'd go in there, there was always a conversation. There was always an argument going on, right? Smith versus Beatles. Where's Rich? Yeah, there was always an argument going on. Dan was always upset about the Mystic Aquarium, right? And it was just a nexus for all the artists, people that love music and love to talk about music, and it still is. I don't mean to make it sound like it was. It still is, and it's still a fantastic place to go to, and thank God it's still around. But that was the second key pillar of Mystic and how the arts thrived during the late 80s and early 90s. I did something wrong. The third pillar was Bernie Boylan's color copies. I'm telling you what, there'd be no flyers, there'd be nothing without Bernie Boylan's color copies. He had a shop where Pizzetta is right now. That's where it started. And bands could not exist. This was pre-social media. If you wanted someone to come to your show, you had to put a flyer up. So people would go to Boylan's, make 100 copies of a flyer. Rich and I did this a million times for 17 Relics and other bands. One of us would hold the flyer up on the telephone pole. The other one would go, dunk, 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 dunk. Right, four staples. We had a staple gun. We'd go around the town, we put up like 100 flyers, to the dismay of all the merchants in town. The flyers, I mean, the telephone poles in Mystic were just covered in flyers. 90% of them were printed at Boylan's, because before that you had to like surreptitiously get your parents to like, or your friends to make copies at work, right? Or, you know, you had to like go to the library and pay, you know, put a dime in the machine like 100 times. So Boylan's was a savior, and it was right, again, we all would park at Densmore. Thank God to Densmore. They were probably not happy. We did a lot of things that probably did not make the merchants of Mystic happy. But everyone could park in Densmore, and you're like really a walk away from Boylan's, walk away from Mystic Disc, walk away from Green Marble Coffee. So it was all together. There was always people down there talking to each other, different types of bands, metal bands, indie bands, different types of musicians, artists, going to the disc. That communication, that talking in person was huge, and it really helped the whole scene thrive. Now, I was involved with Boylan Color Copies, and we did Mason Stoop, which was the first magazine that we put out, and this is actually a copy of it. We just crumpled up some paper. I was working at a Kinko's up at UConn, and I worked second shift so I could get away with making free copies. And we would just literally, that was our cover for the first magazine. And we actually had trouble getting enough art, but we realized there's all these artists around between UConn and back in Mystic that weren't able to be published. There was no avenue, right? It was just like the music. There was no major labels were picking up on this. So we decided we were just gonna make our own magazine and copy it up there. You can see here, it's kind of hard to see with this, but we would actually just use a typewriter at this point. We're going back to like Gutenberg here. Physical impressions of ink on a page. We would take that and blow it up on a photocopier. Like if the title needed to be a little bigger, we would just do 110% of the photocopier, cut it out, paste it down. You can't really see with this, unfortunately, but we pasted down these little strips with a glue stick. We learned this, Rich Martin and I, Rich Martin was the other, he started Hozomeen with me. We learned this because we were both page editors for the Scarlet Tanager at Fitch. And at the time, we were the ones who would kind of put all the paragraphs and everything for the paper. So we learned at the time it would come out on this waxy paper that you could just adhere. You didn't have to use a glue stick. But we learned that when we were 17, 18 years old. And then we just kind of took that same concept here and would type this out. It was tedious. As some of you who are older remember, typing, you know, you had to have your white out and such because you make mistakes. We would take photographs and just glue them down. And then we would copy this. You know, page 36 and page 8, you know, because you had to fold it. I have one here. So I have one here that, you know, the original actually of the Mason Stoop. I don't know if you can see this. But it's literally, you know, we would make double-sided copies. And we'd have to, you know, figure out how it would all work out. And then we would just get a stapler, ba-boom, ba-boom, and put a staple, two staples in it, and then fold it by hand. So it was a very tedious process. We were just making photocopies at this point. We were just using typewriters and enlarging. We found one day the most amazing thing: you could print onto transparency. And when we figured out we could print on transparency, we could do flyers like this. If you can show the next one, that's a transparency, kind of like we layer that over a beautiful photo and get text that way. So this was like a cheap design trick that we use a lot for a lot of flyers. Okay, next. Here's another one that used that. We had a beautiful photo of a contributor, and we just laid over the text on top of it. We're still using typewriters and photocopiers, black and white. We were featured in the small press in Connecticut, which was fantastic. I think I'm running out of time, so we'll just move along here. But they featured us, which was nice. We started getting nuts. We started getting a little crazy. We started printing huge 11 by 17 version of magazine. It actually had an 8.5, a small one inside. These are the kinds of staplers that we used to basically make these by hand. These were all handmade at this point. You can move a bunch. Boom, boom, boom. Keep going. This was a poem I was going to read, but I don't have time. And we also did, we did cassettes for bands. Bands would make cassettes in this age. There was no CD, well, there were CDs, but only if you were really wealthy. We would make cassettes. We made cassette covers. We published books. Here's a book by Rich Freitas of poetry. So we didn't just do the magazines, the Mason Stoop. We also did a lot of books of poetry by certain authors. Next slide. Matt Hannon had a book of poetry here. Next. Matt Curtis had a book of poetry. So we would print these as well. Some of the artists were really prolific, and we felt they needed their own entire book. Here's the final magazine, Magazine 10. It was the last. We did 10 Mason Stoops. It was huge at the time. It got so insane. We were getting so many contributions, I felt terrible to turn stuff down. We could only fit so much in the magazine. It started to get to a point where it was really, really tough. And that's why we ended it. It was just getting a little ridiculous, a little emotionally tough to turn down stuff. So after the 10th one, we were done. And then we started getting insane. We had a color copier came along. We got digital. We went to digital work. We started doing color. And we kind of went off the deep end with the color, with the designs. Here's a CD that we did, a compilation of music. So the biggest thing about Hozomeen Press I want to leave you with is that we were kind of in the mix of it all. We were helping musicians with their flyers. We were eventually doing color flyers. They were going up on telephone poles. We were doing design for CDs and cassettes. So it was a fantastic time. I think everything came together just at the right time. It was pretty amazing how that everything coalesced right at the right moment. You know, we had the press, we had copies, we had music, we had a place downtown where everyone could hang out, and it was just a really special time. So thank you. I apologize for my technical issues here.
Hi, our next speaker is Arden Levine. While not a Mystic native herself, Arden attended Connecticut College between 1997 and 2001. Her presentation will be a distinctive distillation of the fabric that collates the 90s moment. Arden is a poet, author, literary editor, and urban planner, originally from Washington, D.C., and now living and working in New York City. She was saturated in Mystic and New London culture during her years at Conn, She will be reading her new work, including poems from the recent collection Ladies, ABCDary, published by Harbor Editions in 2021. Arden will discuss how the various art forms of female identity assertion in the 90s, from pop music to photography to politics, influence her approach to writing in the current moment. So, Arden Levine.
Hi, everybody. That was a hell of an intro. I'm sure I won't do half of the things that Dan just said I will. But what I will say is that I'm very grateful to be here, that this is incredibly cool, and that I've never had a poem of mine on such a large physical object as is posted over there. We'll come back to that in a second. I grew up in DC, I now live in New York, and I had this moment in history where I lived here, and I was not part of this scene. I have seen envy, but what I can say is that as an urban planner, there's a lot that I learned from being exposed to this part of Connecticut at the moment in history that the other speakers are talking about and making such poignant reference to. There was a dynamic here that I learned about because I was one of those few con students who like left campus. And I think that the most important takeaway for me from that time was that there's different ways of understanding cities, and that the most important and critical element of being part of a city was recognizing its cultural diversity and its artistic diversity and the degree of passion that people are applying to what they're engaging in the context of an urban ecosystem, which is what I still think about now as I think about city planning on a much larger scale. There's so much that was going on here that was a microcosm for what was going on in larger cities around the nation. And in fact, I think a lot about what's being talked about tonight relative to, for example, in DC, where Riot Girl was taking off at around the same time. And there was this presentation of female creativity that was very particular to that moment that wasn't just about art and wasn't just about music. It was also about how women present themselves and the alternative approach to female identity presentation that was also about creating safety, creating sisterhood, creating voice in a literal sense, creating the vocal patterns that would come to define how women would see and speak and sing over the course of the next generation's version of music. And there were women making art at that time that, like, I think a lot about Tori Amos, Andy Leibovitz, people who were doing music in a or art making in a way that really influences how I think about poetry. These tiny biographies of women that are captured in a song or captured in a photograph. And I think about Michelle and the way that she does her artwork and how the way she captures women feels like a legacy not only of the female photographers that came before her, but also of the women who were making songs, and in a direct sense, her as the living legacy of Raleigh McKenna, who was capturing some of the most incredible poets in American letters, such as Lucille Clifton and Adrienne Rich, and creating this intersection between art and poetry that was so powerful. So, kind of, what does that all roll up to in a way? This moment in Mystic's history and in Southeastern Connecticut's history that I got to be sort of tangentially a part of, it absorbed and radiated a lot of what still exists in the literary cultural movements of today. I mean, that poem actually is about to be published in a literary magazine called Ethelzine that is probably a direct descendant of Mason Stoop. It's handmade, it's physically stitched together. And you can see these wonderful lineages in art making, in song making, in poetry assembling that are birthed from a lot of what you're hearing about tonight. And that feels super real to me. And I'm grateful to have this degree of proximity to it. I'll also say I do have this book, which kind of looks zine-like. And that's probably because when I thought about making a poetry book and having it published, I was like, I want it to look like one of those cool objects that I got to hold in my hands back in the 90s when cool people were making cool things that I coveted. But more than that, this book, which I'm going to read from now, is a collection of female biographies in verse. So it is an abecedary, which is an alphabet book. So every poem is titled as a letter, and every letter is a story of a woman. But before I even get to the poems, and I don't know if my co-speakers know this, but this book actually has two epigraphs, and they play off each other a little bit. I've never read the epigraphs before, but I'm going to read them now. The first one is by Thomas Wentworth Higginson, who wrote a piece called Ought Women to Learn the Alphabet, and it was published in The Atlantic in 1859. And it goes, therein the whole question lies. Consider this little fulcrum and Archimedea will move the world before she is done with it. It becomes merely a question of time. Resistance must be made here or nowhere. And the other epigraph is Bikini Kill from Blood One in 1993. I don't fit into your dumb words. Your alphabet is spelled with my blood. So I'm going to read a few poems from this book, but actually before I do that, I wasn't even planning on reading this poem. And I think I'm actually going to go ahead and read it just because I'm so inspired by my other co-presenters this evening. This is a poem I wrote during the pandemic about one of the other speakers you'll hear tonight. And it's called Second Grace, and it uses lyrics from Nick Drake's Pink Moon as part of the poem structure. One, it's 2 minutes, two verses, one really. The lyrics of the verses are the same, briefly then. A, we have a new hi-fi, so S, who once worked in radio, doesn't mind the lockdown. He puts on Brighter Later, its title apt, or aspirational in the confounding first days. Listening to Fly, I hear Nick Drake helplessly stretch for the note to say please. Two. It has 88 words. If you don't draw a distinction between Nick Drake's accusatorily enunciated you, none of you stand so tall, and his half-swallowed ye, pink moon gonna get you all. It has only 25 unique words. B. On my next solitary walk, Spotify spins the album Pink Moon, new to me. For its half-hour length, starting with the title track, Nick Drake whispers goodbye. I'm not yet practiced at mask wearing, perhaps part of why I must stop to sit, my breath coming in short waves. Three. In the interlude between verses, Nick Drake twice sings pink, 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 pink moon. The moon, a seed buried in soft ground below his range. C. Later, I tell S what the algorithm chose. His radio baritone sings pink, 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 pink moon. The moon in his throat darker than the shade Nick Drake could reach. Four. There are two adjectives. Pink, 18 times. Tall, twice. D. S gets sick with the virus. Isolates. I stop taking walks, lean my forehead on the door between. Five. Common associations with the word pink include joy, affection, the flush of good health. A pink moon refers to a full moon reflecting blossoming flowers. A this tender tenor foreboding. Nick Drake might have meant the song as a suicide note. E. When my father took his own life, I returned home after his funeral to find a garden lit with unanticipated buds. My father was better at tending to other humans, and the flowers were perhaps a last cough of wit. His note reminded me to love people. I saw it written, and I saw it say. 6. I kneel and lean my forehead against the wood and hinges that separate us. I kneel and lean my forehead on the ground. Pink moon is on its way. F. At length, S recovers at greater length. My distress wanes. There's more music he has to play for me. 7. With a quiet voice, a bright bloom, G. From healing lungs, he sings. All right. I've got a couple minutes left, so I'm going to introduce you to a couple of these ladies, and I'll lighten the mood a little bit. I think I probably ought to read that poem that's posted over there that people are actually reading right now. So in the book, it's titled C and D. Some girls walk by, smell like they've been up to, down to, everything. They're into, pressed together, damp flowers, clamped between layers, between hours, cool looks kill. Time, their legs are. Their legs between their heels, their hips are. Their tightrope, trapeze, trampoline, swing, stretch, smack. Say, oh, they say, oh, oh, oh. I'll do a couple more. This is a bit of a fan favorite. B. Little she was told she could be whoever she wished in the school pageant, so she chose God. And God would wear a smudge of blue upon her face, and God would wear a gown of paper and language upon her body, and God would wear a crown of buoyant clouds upon her noggin in her throat. God would carry lightning, press it white and hard into attentive air like teeth newly cut through tender gums. In the audience, attendants remark on God. So many times God pissed on me. Often, God has thrown her hands wild like warring starlings. Twice, God briefly disappeared, leaving me blind. Once, God vomited exaltedly into my cupped supplicant hands. Amen. I'll do just a couple more. I should probably also mention that I think I have to say, like, these books are for sale, but what I also have tonight, just especially, is a couple of art prints that were created of some of these poems in the spirit of combining art and poetry. Stop by and say hi if you're interested. Because we are standing right by water, and we'll do Y. Y talks about fluid breathing. How she has aligned the motion of arms and neck and mouth to manage the human need for oxygen. She was born with webbed fingers that catch handfuls of current and pull her through. She, one more wave, she waves. She comes back slick and glinting, flicks her toes. She runs again into open water, and her gait slows not from contact with water, but because she has arrived. The last one I will do is not from the book, but again, it feels like it's sort of the vibe of the evening. And thank you again, you guys, for having me. This is super rad. The Gen Xers in this one will appreciate this. So it's a non-metaphorical poem. I work in affordable housing, and I also write books, so bear with me. Middle. This morning I killed a spider in my shower. I so dislike killing anything, but in this case, the single blow by paper-toweled thumb seemed more humane than the otherwise inevitable death by drain drown. A friend my age wonders aloud to me whether it's a greater accomplishment to build a house or to write a book, and I wonder aloud back at how long the book, how glorious the house. A friend my age wonders aloud to me whether she should modify her old tribal armband tattoo. I am in the middle. Should she add some feminine flourishes, perhaps roses at the end of each aggressive point? Sometimes I am writing a book, and sometimes I am building a house. Is one vain, the other glorious? It might be that both are vainglorious. I killed a spider in my shower this morning, even though it bothered me to do so, because I knew its death would be in vain, no matter if I squashed it or let it spiral away. And there was no good middle in this case. Thanks again, everybody. This is awesome.
Hi, so our next presenter is Michelle Gemma. Michelle Gemma is the photographer who was there and documented the scene in the 90s. Michelle's background includes cutting her teeth as an archivist for the world-renowned photographer Raleigh McKenna, whose home port was Stonington Borough, which was documented flawlessly by the Stonington Historical Society not too long ago in their publication A Village Love Affair, which Michelle participated in as part of the research staff. Many of you may remember her as the manager of the much-missed Stitch in Time boutique, the timeless destination of 90 Mystic Cool. Michelle's presentation will take you through the process that the artists went through to publish their work at houses like Hozomeen Press and to collate their own vision. So, Michelle Gemma.
Static! Work it out, work it out.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have searched the whole world over for the great entertainers.
Hi everyone, thanks for coming out tonight and bearing with all the cool videos and all the great speakers. So, who remembers A Stitch in Time? When I moved back to Mystic in the spring of 1990, I resumed my job at Stitch in Time in downtown. My parents had opened up the boutique in 1973, and they served up fresh denim, clothing, and jewelry from around the world. Stitch in Time was always headquarters for me. I grew up working in the store, and I've basically been behind the counter since I was 5 years old. I still love it, and I'm now carrying on the family legacy at Mystic Army Navy. So I became interested in photography, urged on by my friends who I was contacting since I was back in town, mostly 17 Relics and the like, and I started taking my very first art photos in Scotland in 1992 on a visit over with Matt Hannon. And I illustrated his book, which you just saw the cover for, and soon I was getting requests from other local artists and writers to illustrate their books, so it was really exciting to see my name in print. And as Freitas would often tell me, we were trying to build our own world. If you did the work and you followed through to the point of completion, then you were taken seriously. We held ourselves to very high standards of ambition. Sorry if I'm going in and out on the mic here. If you're going to read at the poetry reading on a weekly basis, then you better have a new poem each week. This is how the books of poetry came together that Matthew Tarbox was talking about. Everyone was urging on each other. And so for me, I could contribute photographs for illustrations, for book covers, cassette covers, and the posters, and prepare work for galleries. We built a collective of artists, and we called it the Greenman Collective. This cassette cover that I did for Delta Venus is actually a photo shoot that I had with one of the models at the collective. Strobe lights, smoke machines, it was pretty cool. We had about 10 bands who shared rehearsal space, and we had a sliding scale of rental fees based on how much time you got. So I built a darkroom there, and it also became a place to have photo shoots and to be immersed in each other's artwork. I was often out there with the band Delta Venus. Again, this is another one of their cassette covers. As they were practicing maybe 3 to 4 times a week, I would go out there with them, work on my photography projects, and then I would see what they were doing, they would see what I was doing, and they would ask me for photos, and I would be inspired. So as you see here, this was a photograph that I took. It's at Elm Grove Cemetery, and I remember showing it to Matt Tarbox one night because we all had a little place together in Noank. And he's like, wow, this is so cool. I could do something, you know, at Boiling Color Copies and like blow it out and make it look really cool. So we also were working with the girls, Eva and Vanessa, that you saw in the first video, and we did the Root of Twinkle. They did the Root of Twinkle, actually. They started it. And but they were the realization of the audience, the importance of the audience. You couldn't put on a show without an audience, and we all worked hard to promote each other's platforms. Even Vanessa, they went to every show, they stayed to interview the musicians, and they always put out sharp and keen observations. So I started to give them some photographs from various on-scene activity, and they always credited, you know, me if I gave them a photograph, Michelle Gemma, photographer and boutique manager. So sounds familiar, right? And they really spread themselves out, and they liked working with a lot of different bands. And so soon they were urging me to give them some more photos. And here we see Lotus, and they were documented in the iconic back booth of BB Dairy. And they ended up using this photo on their CD, Sisyphus and the Indie Rock. So iconic, iconic mystic locales that we miss, of course. Everyone misses BB Dairy. And, but, you know, we use these locales for photo shoots, and then we get to preserve the past in a timestamp. We don't know when something is going to be over, so a good photograph can tell that story for us, and we have those memories. And so this photo starts to talk about how the music scene over at the Greenman Collective was really starting to cook by late 1995. So Dan Kurland, owner of the Mystic Disc, who's been given a lot of props tonight, he decided to release a 15-track CD. So who remembers Trapezium, right? Yeah. So basically featuring all the collective bands, right? So I was given the responsibility for the cover art and photographing each band's portrait. This is some notes from the darkroom. And as you can see, it was really intense. It was about 6 weeks, and I tried to get all these bands in. They were coming in from out of town. I shot all of them at the collective. I remember taking like half the bands, and like each half had a black background, the other half had a white background. And they were very stylized, and they were really cool. And I was also given the responsibility of the cover art, and Matt showed this also, because we were all working together. So he has his photos, and I've got my photos. And I photographed the kids here that you see. This was actually shot at the collective, and I wanted to have a celestial theme, because we're having a lot of dance parties out there, and we were making decorations, like who remembers like the shooting stars and the moons and the glitter. It was like a lot of fun. We had like all sorts of constellations like made up. And so we shot the cover at the collective. I made a trapezium basically like with four models, because trapezium is basically the center of the belt of Orion. Orion is the four brightest stars. And by the time the CD was ready to come out, it was about that June, and the postcard for the show announced, please join us to celebrate the release of Trapezium, a sampler of the region's brightest young stars in the rock and roll nebula. So we're always like working with that symbolism at hand. So we decided to make a magazine because we thought, well, we have to sell like these 500 CDs. So we made a magazine called Postage. And does anyone remember Postage? It went on for about 10 weeks in 1996. Dan Kurland of Mystic Disc, of course, graced the first cover, and he's in his store, and he's holding up a CD, if you can see that. And if you notice his shirt, he's got this cool, like, shooting star, like, stars and moon shirt that he's wearing. So we started to book local shows at the LNG. Who remembers going to those shows? They were a lot of fun. Like, we had tons of bands playing, and took photos, and so the magazine was great because we decided to report on not just the trapezium shows going on, but also starting to cover some more issues and controversies of town. We covered the local rock shows. We had like playwrights, and I remember taking photos. I did all the covers, and we'd go down to Ocean Beach and have these like really sort of artsy covers. Like they weren't just like straight up like news photography. Like we tried to make them sort of interesting. And again, we're always seeking ads, right? You know, a lot of times that's how a magazine exists. You have to have your ad revenue. So we always had our coterie of local stores that we could ask for an ad, Sitchin Time, Mystic Disc, and then later Army Navy, and the bookstore, and some of them are still around. I think there's an ad for Peace Frogs. I don't know if you guys saw that. Ian Hetherington ran Peace Frogs. And so, as you can see, and Matt talked about this, we had to print these magazines, and it was a lot of late nights, and you know, we assembled a lot of volunteers to help us make them. But at this point, I feel like, and Matt did his share of homage, but like I really wanted to say that we should really pay homage to Bernie Boyland. And we're not sure, like we couldn't really get a hold of him for tonight, but basically being the owner of Boyland's, he provided us, everyone in the underground, like the Hozomeen Press kids, the Ruta Twinkle girls, all the bands getting their flyers. You know, he basically provided the infrastructure that we needed to make our art. And, you know, the graphic design, as Matt mentioned, was handled by him and Rich Martin. And they had an evolving crew, actually. So, you know, it was due to Bernie's largesse that a lot of the products were able to be made. And, you know, he sometimes, like, I found some old receipts in my notebooks. And it's like we had a payment scale where we had to, like, give him, you know, $50 a week to cover a printing cost. So, but we should make a statue. We feel Bernie Boyland should be one statue in town and maybe Dan Curlin on the other. So I think sometime in the near future we should work on that because you have to pay homage. So now we're going to talk about the skateboarders. So I don't know who here was like a skater in the 90s, but you know, back then the merchants got a little out of hand sometimes and wanted to try to reprimand them for being in the wrong place at the wrong time. And so me and Jeff Paprocki, and I don't know if he's here tonight, but we decided to start the My Stick Skateboard Association. And to do that, we really had to organize, like, I was kind of a bridge between the merchants, like being the manager at Sitchin Time. I wasn't yet at the Army Navy store. And, you know, I sort of took Jeff under my wing because I felt like some of the merchants felt that he was this ne'er-do-well with Fuse and a few of the CBS, you know, shenanigans. But, you know, they were just looking for a safe and fun environment. And, you know, every kid wants to see and be seen. I mean, that's just how it works. You know, every generation of kids, we go through the same cycles. So I decided to join the local Downtown Merchants Association, and I joined, like, the advertising committee or something, and, you know, to gain the credibility of my older merchants. And it worked. We were assigned some first night gigs. We booked bands. We could actually pay the band's money, which was exciting. We had first night shows at, like, the old firehouse down here, the Oral School, like, before it was, like, a wreck. And then I even got the skaters, and we just saw that. I'm not timing my speech exactly with every photo, but you saw the kids skating in down the streets of Downtown Mystic. That was actually the May Day parade, and I sort of asked if I could get the skaters in there. And in fact, James Maple, the owner of Lamplighter, is here tonight, and there's a shot of him. He's like 14 years old, and he's skating while carrying a skateboard, which like we found really odd and sort of funny and adorable. So and then we started to have these competitions, and we got Donny Barley and Brian Anderson and a few other skaters to be the judges, and the kids were really excited. So, you know, it was all about bringing it around and, like, believing in the kids and allowing them a place to show us that what they could do when they were given the trust of, you know, some of their elders. And, like, we all need to have that chance. So, let's see. Here we are trying to rent a space in Pawcatuck. Me and Rich Freitas and Matt Tarbox and David Bentley were sort of like the admin people of our art movement. And Rich Martin also was there quite a bit. And we would try to get a space. First, it was the Greenman Collective, as you see here. But we were trying to get a space where we could actually have retail and shows. And our proposals were usually shot down. But, you know, we have site proposals. We gave them photos and drawings. Dave's dad was an engineer, so we were able to get some really professional work done. But we just thought that it was really important to try to get like the business-minded aspect of what we were trying to do out there as well. And we knew that we had to be taken seriously. So we were mindful of that respect. We always worked with artists who were sometimes much older than us, even by 10 years. and when we met with these landlords of these commercial spaces that we wanted to rent, we always try to be professional. And we had to use our business skills. I mean, you know, we're renting apartments, and then we had rent at our apartment, rent at the collective. We had two electric bills. We had two phone bills. So, you know, it took a little bit of business savvy as well to make your art and get some ad revenue from local businesses to pay for the cost. And we had to rent PAs and equipment for when we had our parties. So, you know, basically, here's some examples of some art that I was doing as well to contribute. And, you know, we just had to keep working on our art. I remember a professional artist telling me, if you're not working on your art daily, are you really an artist? I mean, that's sort of severe, but, you know, we took that seriously. We had submission deadlines, we had gallery shows, we had to prepare for an opening. It was real. So I started to work on a book of photography, and there's James right there, actually, with Angela. We shot down at the train station. He's wearing a Celtics jersey. So at this point, it's getting to be the late 90s, and I started photographing this one model. Her name is Morgan Vale, and here she is. This is our first photo shoot. That's at Portersville Academy on High Street. And she was 12. And at that point, I was inspired by Sally Mann's book, which was called At 12. It was all photographs of 12-year-olds. And I thought, well, I've just met this girl, and she's 12 years old. So there's sort of this synchronicity of, like, this is the girl. Like, you should photograph her. She ended up being my neighbor, and I knew her sister, who worked at the Puritan and Genesta health food store. Who remembers P&G? Yeah, loved that place. Oh, my God. So I'm working on the book, and look for it. It's going to be a 20-year study of this girl. She was 12. Now, the book is going to end with her turning 31, but of course, I'm already working on the second volume because she's now older than 31. So now I'm going to turn over my spot to, we're going to see a video that I just made. That's my newest artistic creation. Ellery Twining released his record, Revenge, and I was inspired to make a video for Weatherall because the words of the song, if you listen to it, it's a study in what we did during the 90s when we had our dance parties at Mars Hall, and I just felt like I could use some photos, and we're going to see the video. Dan's going to introduce the video really quickly. So thanks again for coming, everybody. I appreciate it.
A bittersweet that because I lost all my high school girlfriends to skaters. I did. I really did. I was not a bad boy. I wasn't cool. No, people are not interested if you're playing JV soccer at Fitch. So what we're about to see is the Weatherall video. And mystic musician Ellery Twining released his debut solo record, Revenge, in January of this year. Michelle went digging in her photo archives and decided to create a video for the first single, Weatherall, a tribute to the groundbreaking English producer DJ, who passed as Ellery was writing his album. The following video presentation is a quilt of many mystic moments. The dance hall created by the kids at 15 Washington Street, the infamous Mars Hall, now a vacant lot behind the Henny Penny, coupled with the solar flare, the dance nights, and the infamous, it really was infamous, mystic workshop in the 2010s. Also making an appearance is The Ghost, which many of you may be familiar with. So here we go, Weatherall.
I thought I had an obligation, so we sent out the invitation to pass on knowledge, surviving decades for the next generation. We built a disco in the attic, played your records to get the people to dance. Under any circumstance, to get the people to dance. I didn't realize it was a haunted dance hall. When the house was torn down that next week, the final demolition found us in handcuffs.
So our final presenter of the evening is Stephen Chapaska. So Stephen was one of the earliest serious crate diggers at the Mystic Disc in the 90s. "I'm escaping Montville," he would mutter underneath his breath while scouring the store for XTC records. Stephen didn't need to shop the store every week. He already owned all of the cool records. Very few people are that far ahead of the curve, but Stephen was. He even bought a copy of The Birds Younger Than Yesterday one day, and after paying for the record, promptly handed it back to disc owner Dan Curlin as a gift to his newborn daughter, Lena. Let that be the first record in her collection. So good. And so Stephen will be reading an original work prepared just for this evening. Stephen Chapaska.
Thank you. Thank you, Dan. And thank you to the Mystic Note Library as well. But whenever I speak before or do any public speaking or perform or anything in front of people, I'm always reminded of a quote by the late Neil Innes, the comedian and musician, who once said, "I've suffered from my art, and now it's your turn." So, Michelle asked me to participate tonight. She said she wanted me to do Stephen things, but by which I thought she meant I can watch English soccer for 6 hours straight. Instead, I'm going to talk. We'll see if that's an improvement. And I'd like to talk about participation, actually. Because thinking back to all those years ago and reading and meeting and being around all these musicians and artists and being neither a musician or an artist of any sort, I didn't really feel I could join in that way. But in the end, I felt like a participant. And with your indulgence, I'm going to sort of root around in that and try to figure out what it means. So depending on how you sort of twist the lens, I'm not a local to here, but southeastern Connecticut to be sure. I'm not from Mystic. As Dan mentioned, I grew up in Montville. Montville is both geographically and existentially located between Norwich and New London. And so was I, actually. I was born in Bacchus Hospital on the day before Jimmy Carter was elected, and my mother worked in Norwich, and my dad worked in New London. The Caldor was in Norwich. The Bradleys was in New London. But I won't go into much of my misspent youth in Montville, just a bunch of really bad, you know, being bad at baseball and then being, and then following the seasons into soccer and being bad at that too. But it was how I reached junior high school. And I went to junior high school, which is, I think, is different than middle school. It just, there's something about those two words, middle school, junior high. There's a sort of menace, I think, to junior high school. But being in Montville, it didn't really feel so much like a, it didn't even feel like a home planet, let alone a hometown. But there were two things that happened there that were sort of elemental to discovering Mystic and how I viewed it in the 1990s. First, I like a lot of people have mentioned here tonight, I've discovered the left of the dial. I discovered WCNI. And also discovered the left of the television when MTV put on 120 Minutes. And so happened, there was a punk rock sort of skater kid at the Murphy School, the junior high in Montville, called Adam. And I didn't really have anything to do with skateboarding either. I preferred golf. But I sat next to Adam, and I'd recently heard that the song Stand by R.E.M. on the radio, and I did my best to copy down the lyrics and like ask my English teacher what it meant, what all the lyrics meant. And Adam that day had an R.E.M. cassette. It was a document. And we got to talking about it, and he mentioned WCNI to me, and he mentioned it 120 minutes to me. And he said, well, that's all this music is. So on to the summer of 1990, just before high school, when staying up late felt subversive. I stayed up late on Sunday night and watched the 120 minutes on MTV, and I saw the video for Cool Thing by Sonic Youth. And then I hope you sort of forgive the cliche, but it was like the road to Damascus. It was the sound of the guitars. They were loud, not Motley Crue loud, but they were in the band. You know, they didn't look like pop stars. They looked scuzzy and sexy, I guess, and though I didn't know what that meant. And I guess in retrospect, I felt rearranged by all that, you know, all shook up, to go back to rock and roll traditional. To use a term these days that's sort of best used with the proper gloves and goggles, it gave me an identity, well, there's all these bands with these cool names like Gene Loves Jezebel and Midnight Oil or Stone Roses. Back then, that identity was really important to me, and I have the Let's Active Records to prove it. The other major character in all this is of course the Roman Catholic Church. I was sent off to St. Bernard, but I don't have that horror story Catholic school thing you hear. It was a wonderful time. Actually, I don't mean to advertise, but I feel very lucky to have gone there, and it changed my life. Actually, and dead serious, because I didn't know anybody beyond Montville, really, and so there were people there from other towns like Baltic and Moosup and Mystic, and St. Bernard those days they gave you they had this program called peer ministry, the peer minister where they pair a freshman with a senior, and they would sort of be a mentor to you, my mentor was called Sal, and we sort of bonded, actually, over, we both really liked Billy Bragg, and he played drums in a band called Adam's Onus. Just to do a bit of live copy editing for you, Adams is not with an apostrophe S. The name comes from the treaty by which Spain ceded Florida to the United States, the Adams being John Quincy Adams, and the other person was Luis de Onís, the Spanish envoy. You're not writing any of this down. Sal introduced me to Dan, who was the guitar player in the band, and John, who played bass. And I started hanging out with them, and I started hanging out here in Mystic. And we're being super hyper ultra parochial here. I this was a different world to me. There were sobs. And in it, like other people mentioned, in a divine act of providence, the Mystic Disc and the Green Marble, the cool record store, and cool coffee house side by side. I mean, there was a place to go. I mean, I can't. That was the thing about this place. There was a place. I mean, you've all heard the Gertrude Stein quote about Oakland. You know, there's no there there. But when growing up in Montville, it had less of a there than the there that Oakland doesn't have. You know, so I started coming to the band's rehearsals, such as they were. Eventually became something of a roadie. Sal kept his drums in a garage next to his father's vintage 1960s Corvettes. And they were really beautiful, and they were in the way of the door. And many a time I would carrying like floor toms over a Corvette, and you know, and by some act of miraculousness, I didn't drop one. The band, Adam Zonis, how to describe them? Well, sort of like they were like REM fronted by J.R. Tolkien, playing the Grateful Dead's Blues for Allah backwards. I hadn't listened to it in a while, actually, just before they played that song. I believe that was Bethesda. But the band started playing over at the German Club over that way. And there were all these bands that had all these fantastic names, like people said, the Alexander Field and Lotus Eaters and 17 Relics. And it was only a few dollars to get into these shows. And there were all these teenagers, and they were like beautiful girls there. And that was something I was interested in. And they all looked like they could have been in Sonic Youth videos. I hang out with the band. When I got my driver's license, I became even more of a roadie. I was driving them around. I felt like, do you know Mal Evans, who was the roadie for the Beatles? Anyway, we were discovering, you know, new music and Pete's Wicked Ale and other things. And hanging out with all these weirdos and meeting all the people here, it felt sort of tantamount to citizenship, you know, or a participant, you know. Around this time, I sort of got the language bug, and it should have been something blindingly obvious to do, was to write about music, participate in the thing that you love, right? But Dan was always actually very encouraging, and he had nice things to say about me writing. He suggested I write about music, but I never really did. But it just so happened that when I was in college, Adam Zonis broke up, and I don't really remember the year. I guess it was 1996. I always remember it would have been the summer that Letters to Cleo show at the LNG. I always thought if the music scene around here ever pulled off a proper Storm the Bastille revolution, the new calendar would start with that Letters to Cleo show. Anyway, the band broke up, and around the time the Postage zine, which you saw earlier, I was asked to write something for them, or I wrote sort of an obituary for the band, and that was the first time I'd been published. If I could have used the expansive term of the definition, music journalism. Then I got to interview for Postage as well, the Velvet Crush drummer. They're a band, really wonderful band from Providence. Their drummer Rick Mank, who played outside of Van and outside the LNG club, and played Rumors on cassette. In the van while we played. I always went out and bought Rumors on cassette and just kept it in my car as a sort of a totem and occasional listen. And so that was sort of the North Star for the rest of my life, all that sort of stuff. I thought of myself as a music writer then, and probably with a news writer. Participating in all these places where I lived and the publications, which I was grateful for having me. The word participant evolved from part, which began its word life as the Latin pars, which was related, many think, to parare, which means to make ready. And I like that the first bunch of language molecules for the word participate means to make ready, to join in, to be part of something, a connection, something to be fastened to. But it has something in its DNA that's something that's active and has a sense of anticipation. So from the standpoint of musicians and the artists, I was a bit on the periphery, but all these things that happened here all those years ago. But I came here and found myself surrounded by people who were looking for a little magic, and I was too, and they made it for themselves and for others. I don't know what it all means, but why not? I'll give it a go, of modesty. I shall make a bit of a meaning, a bit of a confession. Before this thing tonight, I hadn't really written anything in really quite some time. Sometimes that bothers me, and sometimes there's 6 hours of English soccer on. But having a chance to think about all the music, the art, the photography, the poetry, all that happened here, I'm so happy to have, in my own way, participated in it. And thinking about it now, I'm happy and proud to have participated tonight and participate again. It's always there. Going to go about when you go about and make ready for the next part. Thank you.
This was a lot of fun and a truly beautiful evening. And I hope that you will take a moment. We have, there is a video presentation, a music presentation, but I hope you will take a moment to join me in thanking the organizers, the sponsors, and our presenters this evening. What an exceptional fun time. Thank you.
Thank you. Always remind me of you.